Okay, this is lesson, well, we're going to call it lesson 4.1.1. It's going to fit in between chapter 4 because it doesn't have it in the book that I'm using, and I really think that it's something that at this point in time it would be useful for you to know how to do this. To do what, you ask? Well, this is what we're going to do. Let me get out of this for a minute. Let me go to Google for a minute. And go to images, not Google. How about slot machine? And that's good enough. We'll see what we get. All right, so I'm looking at a series of pictures here with slot machines in them. And I don't want to find an old one because an old one doesn't use electronics. There we go. How about something like that? Or something like this. Okay. There's kind of a newfangled slot machine, or at the very least, it's a gambling game. How did the computer come up with Ace of Diamonds, Jack of Spades, King of Spades, Jack and Queen? How does it come up with stuff like that? Now, really, if it's fair, it has to generate random. It can't just generate a series of cards. Or let's say even just a series of numbers. If we go back, I mean, it's not always that type of stuff. It's, you know, stuff that looks like this sometimes too. How does it come up with, you know, two plums and a cherry? Well, it randomly generates them somehow. How does it randomly generate? How do you get a computer that really doesn't know anything to just randomly, like a set of ping pong balls inside of that air thing, whenever you watch TV and they're saying, we're going to, you know, do the lotto today, and you got those ping pong balls coming up out of the vacuum tube. That's fairly random. But electronically, how do you get it to do that? Almost the same way. But we have to find something electronically that constantly changes in order to generate random numbers. Now, there's something that constantly changes in life. Do you know what that would be? And something that constantly changes on a computer. I'm going to get out of this. What do you think that is? And I'm going to pan down here for a minute at the bottom right-hand corner. I'm going to click here, and then I'm going to circle. What keeps changing? Time. Time keeps changing. I want you to think of time, and just go by seconds, let's say. Every second that goes by, consider that to be a page. So every second that goes by, it's a page that turns. So 1 second goes by, it's on page one. Another second goes by, it's on page two. And on each page, there are a series of numbers. And it picks one of those numbers. That's essentially what electronic randomization is. It uses the internal clock of your computer to randomly generate numbers. Now, it's more complicated than that, but that's as simple as I can make it. And I don't understand it 100% myself. That's just the way that I think about it as I'm going through this. Now, in C++, it's a lot more difficult to start generating. They call them seed numbers and things like that. In Java, it's actually quite a bit simpler to get started using random numbers than it is in any other language that I've ever taught or used. Why don't we get started, and you can see what I mean. I want to generate a series of random numbers. So let's do that. So we're going to start a new class. We're going to call it something with random in it. How about random? How about this? First random. That makes sense. And we're going to double click. I probably should have done this ahead of time, but I didn't. Forgive me. And I want to make sure that you can see all of this here, so hopefully you can. I want to make sure that's inside of here. Okay, so here we have our program. Let's get rid of all the comments. You're used to this. We're going to comment all that stuff, get rid of it. So we just have our public class. It's called First Random. Now, what do we usually do up here? Things are going to change a little bit. Well, we usually went import java.util. And then we either put an asterisk, or I said, if you just want to put scanner with a capital S, you can do that too. It's basically the same thing. Scanner just imports a scanner class, where the asterisk imports quite a bit more. I'm going to leave it at scanner for now because I want to distinguish between scanner and something else that we're going to use. Now we have to import one more thing. You want to import a class in Java that's already been created for you, so you don't have to do it again, called, ready for this? Random. Kind of makes sense. That sets you up to use the internal clock. It sets you up to use random numbers, and you don't have to worry about a whole lot. It really does a lot of the work for you. Now, let's go back into this class. We want to make it a main program, right? So we're going to say should have done this ahead of time, I know. I'm wasting time. Okay. So public static void main string args. So we're all set with that. That doesn't look right for some reason. And it isn't. I think those are curly braces. There. Okay. Do you remember after you declared a couple of variables? Let's say we declare some interval. We're going to call this one number. We're going to call something loop. I'm going to put an X in there. How did we get it so, we're not going to do this, but again, I'm using an analogy. I'm just kind of showing you how we're going to use random numbers from the scanner that you've used all along. Remember when we wanted to make it so a user could input something in for, let's say, X? Remember how you had to declare, kind of an object for the scanner class? You had to say something like, scanner. It was almost like you were declaring another variable. So instead of int number, we're going to say scanner, and then you called it something. And what we generally called it was, you know, key input or keyboard or something like that. So you're declaring keyboard, and that's going to be a new. Hopefully you remember this because you do it almost every single time. And you almost do it without thinking at this point, I'm sure. But you always put that in there. Now the next thing I want to do, just on the off chance that things mess up, is I want to, remember this, I told you this is system.out.println. Shouldn't have to do this, but sometimes you do. We're just going to print nothing, because a lot of times it'll just, once you compile the program, it just keeps chugging and nothing happens. We're really all set to start a program. The only thing different so far has been that little random thing up at the top. No, I just want to see if this is working, just so I know I didn't make a mistake in the main stuff that we did. So let's say we allow for an input. So let's say I want the user to input a number in for x. So remember how we did this? We went x equals, and then I have to look up back here and say, okay, what was the variable I used for input? Okay, it was called keyboard. So I said keyboard, and then remember, dot, and then next, and then whatever you want. You want next double, you want next int, next line. But obviously we're just doing next in. And then if you wanted to, system.out.println. And that's it. So what is this program going to do? Nothing. It's going to allow the user to input a variable, an integer, and then it's going to output that integer. That's all it does. But I want to, again, I'm just testing this to see. Oh no, what have I done? System.out.println. Oh, I spelled it wrong. There you go. All right, so that seems to be working okay. So let's go to here. I'll run it, see what happens. So I got, let me clear all that out. So if I input 5, it should output 5. Marvelous. Easy. Okay. Now, it's not what I wanted to do, but I wanted to see if everything was working, and it is. So I'm going to keep all this. I'm going to keep, actually, I shouldn't keep that at all. But I'm going to keep that here. We don't need it, but I'm going to keep it there, and I'll show you why in a minute. I'll keep that there too. I don't need that, so I'm going to get rid of these two. All right, so what do we want to do? Well, what we want to do at this point is we want to start, let's say, I'm trying to, off the top of my head, let's say we're going to make a loop that goes from 1 to something, 1 to 10. Let's just say that. We're going to create a loop that goes from 1 to 10 because I want to generate a series of random numbers. I don't want to just generate one number. I want to show you kind of what happens as you generate a series of random numbers as we go through this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go 4, and then let's use, we have loops, that makes sense. For loop equals 1, remember this, semicolon, space, and then loop is less than or equal to, let's say 10, and then we can shortcut it by going loop plus plus, and anything that goes inside of that loop, it's going to do it, you know, whatever it does, it's going to end up doing it 10 times because you're looping from 1 to 10. And notice that there's no semicolon after loop. Don't forget that. Okay. Let's go back up here for a minute. Right up here. We have scanner keyboard equals new scanner system ini. Why do we have that? Well, because we needed to have an object of the scanner class that we used. I erased it already. Down here. For input, and that's what scanner is, it's input. I don't need scanner for anything. But what I do need now, because I'm going to generate random numbers, is a variable that we're going to use that's from the random class. So if I just went like this, random, and then I picked, I'll call it rnum for like random num, just anything. So you declared something called rnum. And that rnum is just basically it's a random, just like number is an int. This now is a random. And we want to make that a new. Well, I don't want to make it a new scanner because it doesn't make sense. I'm going to make it a new random. And then that's it. So what I just did was I created kind of like a variable that's of the class random, and now I can use that to output whatever I want to. Oops, sorry, got my casino stuff popping up on me here. Okay, sorry, where was I here? All right, so I've got my integers declared. I've got random declared is rnum. And don't forget, I'll put it back in. I'm going to put scanner, and I think we use keyboard. I should have kept it up here. I know I should have left it. New, and then I'm going to call it, you know, scanner. And then remember system. Okay, so remember how we had that there? I'm going to get rid of it in a minute anyway. And what we did was, down here, if we wanted to have the user input, we put something that said, like, keyboard. And then we went dot next int. Remember that, and then we set it equal to a variable, and we can call the variable, you know, x is equal to keyboard.nextInt, and we had parenthesis and whatever, and we had that new scanner, and then we had system.in here. I might as well just type it all in. Just I want to make sure that I have that in there so I can kind of associate it with the new thing. So you have scanner, and then it's keyboard is equal to new scanner system ion. And then down here you said, okay, I'm going to take a variable x, and I'm going to allow the user to input for x. So the way you, and it's going to be an integer. So the way you did it was you said, okay, I have to make sure x is an integer up here, and it is. And I have to use that object keyboard that I created up here, because keyboard is the object for the class scanner. And it looks like it's all working. Now look here. I did the same thing with random. It's essentially, you don't have to do all that stuff. It's essentially the same thing. Instead of scanner, keyboard, it's random, and I could use anything I want. Rnum. And that's a new random. So that becomes our object right here. Now what methods do we want to perform with that object? Well, you're going to find out it's the same thing as we did with keyboard. NextInt. So let me get rid of this. I know that's probably confusing. Let me get rid of that. I'll put this back up here. I will I don't need that. I'll get rid of it. Okay. Now, well, what do? We essentially do the same thing. Come on, Pat. My goodness. And just leave it alone. What I want to do down here is I want to generate a random number or a series of random numbers. How? Well, I want to do that by inside of the loop where we had x equals, and then we called it, something keyboard in this case, dot next int. I want to kind of do the same thing by saying I'm going to take one of the variables number, because that's an int, and I want that to be equal to, instead of keyboard, I'm going to put rnum dot next int. And that's it right there. That's all I want to do. Now, what's going to happen right now is something either freaky or nothing at all, and nothing at all. And I'll show you in a minute here. Let me actually compile this, and then we'll run it, and I'll show you what I mean. So when we go to run this, you should pretty much get, let me take all this junk out. I keep forgetting to clear it. Okay, we got nothing at all. So I either thought it was going to be something weird or nothing at all, and it went for the nothing at all. Why? Well, there's some things we haven't done quite yet that we have to. Let's go back. The new part is set up for random numbers. Done. Next, get a variable. I shouldn't call it a variable anymore, but I do. Have an object called rnum, random num, and create one. Okay, so we did that. Now, go down here and take one of your variables and set it equal to the random number that you just said you're going to use up here that you created, and we want it to be an integer. Well, why didn't it do anything? Well, a couple of reasons. First reason is you didn't print anything out, and the second thing is you didn't tell it anything specific about the random numbers. So let's do this then. Let's go, well, okay, what if we printed something out? And let's just say we printed a number. Because really, number is what? Number is just this. So it says number is equal to one of these things, and it's not scanner, so it doesn't wait for input. It just does it. And so print out number. Now, how many times is it going to print out number? Well, it's going to print out number 10 times because I have it looping 10 times. So it's going to go into this loop and say print out the number, print out the number, print out the number 10 times. Well, is it going to actually do that? Well, let's see. It's either going to print nothing or it's going to print something really weird out. So let's see what it does. It printed something pretty weird out. It looks like all these numbers are just all over the place. You have two gazillion and whatever. Those are random numbers, though. So it looks like it seems to be working. But what are you going to do with numbers that are that big? How are you going to take that and do anything with it as far as a casino game goes? Remember how I said that consider as time passes, every little tiny millisecond that goes by, it flips a page and it picks a number on that page? Well, that's what's happening. At a certain point in time, it went to a page and I guess that was the number. And I went to the other one, I guess that was a number. And I went to another one, and I guess that was a number, and so on. And it picked all these numbers. How can we manipulate those numbers? Now, in C++, it was very time-consuming to teach because you had to go through something called mod. And mod basically was remainder, and the way that you manipulate and you can work with random numbers was through using remainders. Java makes it quite a bit easier because I think it probably does the same thing, but it doesn't make you go through all the work to get to it. Let me clear this because it's usually. What does it do? Well, let's go back into it. Watch how easy this is. All I'm going to do is inside these parentheses here, I'm going to type in 10. No, I'm not going to use 10 because I'm looping 10 times and it'll get confusing. I'm going to type in 8. So this is what it's saying. I want number to be a random and I want it to be an integer. Now, what does that 8 mean? It basically means I want you to use, well, I'll tell you what, you tell me what it does. Okay, I compiled it, and I probably should have looped like 50 times so you could see a little bit better as to what it does, but we'll do it this way. That was the series of numbers. I'm going to go and I'm going to click here. Okay, there's 8 right there. And what numbers did I get? Well, I got a 0. I didn't get any 1s, but I could have, I'll tell you that. I got a 2, 3, 4, I got a 5, I got a 6, I got a 7. So those are all the numbers I got, and they're all integers. Well, let me run this again. Let me clear this out. Let me run again. Compile. Oh, what am I doing that for? Let me get out of that. Let's run it one more time. Let's see what we get. Okay, this time I did get a 1. This time it generated a series of random numbers and 10 of them, but I got a couple of 4s, 0s, 5s, 3s. Huh. I went up to 8. And every time I keep running this, well, let me do it again. Let me, instead of going from 1 to 10, let me just go from 1 to 40, and we'll generate 40 random numbers with the 8 there. And let's see what that does. Let's compile it. Let's run it. See what it does. And we'll take a peek. Don't forget the number 8 that I used. Okay, so I got some 3s, 1, 7, 6, 5, 7, 2. I got 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7s. Do you notice what's not there? The 8. There's no 8 there. When I used an 8, it gave me numbers starting at 0. It looks like, because I don't see any negative numbers. And the biggest number I seem to see is a 7. So when I use an 8, it gives me numbers from 0 to 7. Which kind of makes sense, because it goes up to 8, but not including 8. That's kind of what a remainder for 8 is. Let's see if that theory's correct, though. Let's use something other than 8. Let's use, how about 17? So if that's the case, and we're looping 40 times, 17 is going to be tough to figure out. We should see numbers that go from 0 to 17, but 17 shouldn't be included. So I guess from 0 to 16. So if I ran that, let's see if we have numbers from 0 to 16. You see any zeros there? No? I think it's probably just a coincidence. I don't even see any ones. But I certainly don't see any 17s either. I see a few 16s, a couple of them. But I don't see any 17s. What if I ran it again? Okay, there's the 0. I see it now. Still the same set of numbers. But again, I used 17 and I don't see any 17s. So it kind of looks like that's the case, doesn't it? It looks like that when you want to generate random numbers, the way you manipulate it is whatever number you put in, it gives you, and if it's an integer, it starts at 0 and goes up to that number but does not include that number. That really is what remainder is. If you think about it, what are all the remainders you can have when you divide by, when you divide using 17? Anywhere from 0 to 16. And that's kind of what it's doing. So here's my question to you. What does a die have? If you want to roll 2 dice, what does a die have? It has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, doesn't it? What's the problem with putting a 6 in there? Well, let's see. You probably already know. The problem with putting a 6 in there is that when you go to run it, you're going to get 0, which that's not part of a die. And you're not going to get, that was from the last one, don't ignore those. You're not going to get a 6, because when you type in 6, it goes up to 6, but it doesn't include it. So how does that work? So do we use 7? Well, all right, let's try 7 then. So let's go to 7, because 7, if we type in a 7 here, up here, then we should be able to run this and it'll go up to 6, right? No, but that doesn't work either because you can't have 0 for a die. When you roll a die, it's 1 through 6. So there's got to be other ways to manipulate, but you can kind of see that this is the starter. And we'll get to that later.